Welcome to the Pure Performance Cafe. May I take your order?
Yes, I would like a shot of Pure Performance, please.
Coming right up.
Welcome to another episode of Pure Performance Cafe, this time with Ernst Ambichl, one of our chief software architects. Hi, Ernst.
Hi, Andreas.
Hey. So I know this is your first podcast, I think so at least, with me, I believe.
It is,
so.
Yes. Yeah.
And we're sitting here in the Linz office, and a couple of weeks ago, you did a presentation for an AWS meetup that we hosted here in Linz, and you talked about the Dynatrace architecture, right? You had a lot of things that you explained, how the architecture works and how you came up with certain architectural concepts and how SaaS and managed works. And I really liked it, and I thought I want to just ask you to summarize the highlights. And maybe, Ernst, just like, you know, just get started. Think, what were the requirements that you had, and then we just have a conversation about it.
Sure. So, I mean, we started with basically Dynatrace, the new product within Dynatrace almost 6 years now ago. And we had pretty challenging requirements coming from our CTO at that point in time. So to summarize on them, we wanted to support more than 10,000 hosts on that platform, on a single platform, basically, for monitoring. The system, the software needed to run in a SaaS environment as well as in an on-prem environment. So both deployment models needed to be supported. We wanted to operate it, of course, as it is SaaS. That means we wanted to minimize the operational effort related to bringing the deploying the platform, updating the platform, monitoring the platform. Also, as we are monitoring other systems and getting basically part of the core infrastructure of our customers, it was key that our availability is even higher than the availability of our customers' applications. So we had a very high requirement on availability. So 99.99 to 999. So it's this depends. So we are going to 999 now. Also, we needed to be able to support release cycles, very short ones. So we are updating the system every 2 weeks. So we are getting a new installation out. So deployment, easy deployment, easy updates was key for us. So these were basically the requirements we had at that point in time. And first of all, it was challenging. The first thing we already know about, it needs to be a clustered architecture. It can't be something that is only scalable vertically. We need to scale it horizontally. There's no way that you can scale up to that level of monitoring agents that we wanted to support. So that was the first principle thing we had to keep in mind. It needed to be clusterable. Another thing also very important to mention is it needed to be able to support multiple tenants or multiple customers, especially for the SaaS environment. But it also needed to be able to support a single tenant, which basically is a huge tenant within one environment. So it needed not only to support many small tenants, but also one big customer on one cluster. So that basically was the key cornerstone requirements that we had at that point in time. So we came up with an architecture, and let's say this was really guided by the requirement that it needs to run in SaaS as well as in on-prem, which is very easy to install and does not require a myriad of components to run it. That means, I mean, you can think about the cluster architecture is, there is a front-end a proxy component which helps us to minimize the network traffic that goes to the next component. That means it does the things like load balancing, it does the things like bulking of messages. So it helps us to load off the network traffic and the network chattiness that comes in when 10,000 or more agents are connecting to a platform. So this was, we call that currently Active Gateway. So that's the entry point architecture built on mostly Java technology. I mean, we are using a load balancer in front of to do SSL payload or offload on SSL payloads and handshakes. So that's the entry point architecture. The next tier really is the server node, what we call the server nodes, which can scale. Of course, you can add server nodes as well as you can add active gateways in as you want or as you need. And the server node is doing all the real-time processing. That means it's basically getting in all the monitoring data. It does real-time correlation of the data as well as it serves the web UI. So we are not distinguishing server nodes between doing ingest data processing and on-demand web UI processing. So this is all done within one server node. So it's we can split it up, but currently we don't do it, mostly because of the requirement of the ease of deployment. Mm-hmm. That means these are the processing nodes. The storage architecture behind is based on standard high-performing... We called it sometimes NoSQL databases. So Cassandra is one of our cornerstones to store all the metric data. We are using Elasticsearch for storing user behavior data out of the requirement that this data needs to be very flexible, searchable, which is different to metrics data, where you usually know what you want to see and you need a way to easy basically aggregate the data and very fastly deliver time series data. And as a third data store of the core platform, we use a homegrown file-based distributed data store for storing the raw data. So if you know Dynatrace, I mean, the essence of what we are doing is we are storing traces on service calls and all these events. So each web request that we are tracing, that we are monitoring, each database call that we are monitoring basically lands in this raw data store that enables us to do all what we call on-demand analysis on pure paths, on aggregation on pure paths. And this data store is distributed, which means it comes with each and every server node. There's a local data store to that server. Therefore, all the queries get distributed, and you can think of it, it's very scalable in that terms, because you add a server node and you add storage for that server node, which means if you do queries against a complete set of, let's say, pure paths, we're going out to all the servers and collect the data, so it scales. So that was one of the main decisions. Also, the components like Cassandra or Elasticsearch are all horizontally easily scalable. So that's the base architecture. The differences now between SaaS and on-prem are really in how we deploy this architecture. In SaaS, we are pretty flexible. We are working in AWS. That means for each server node type, we are creating our own instance. That means a typical cluster deployment would look like three server nodes running on dedicated instances, three active gateways running also on dedicated instances, six Cassandra nodes running on dedicated instances, and also Elasticsearch comes also in with 3 to 6, depending on how much traffic we see. Of course, we can scale that, but that would be the first setup. So about 20 instances that we use for that cluster at that point in time. That has an advantage, of course, because we can scale it on what's demanded. So if we see there's a bottleneck or there's a more demand on Cassandra traffic, then we can just add a node on Cassandra. Or if there's a server, let's say server under high load, we add a node on the server. And of course, by using AWS and our deployment mechanisms there, it's pretty easy to get a new cluster started. This is about half an hour, and a new cluster is basically up and running. Also, the update is completely automated, so we are automating all these components and use, of course, AWS services to assist us with deployment and provisioning. For on-prem, where customers are installing the system, that would be too complicated for customers to needing 20 instances for a cluster to run. So we decided to basically bundle all the components that we use, the active gateway, the server nodes, Cassandra, Elasticsearch, within one instance type. So you can install a node that serves all the different node types. Mm-hmm. That means you even can start with a single node deployment. So you can install it on a single machine. It even runs on my laptop here. Mm-hmm. So that's the minimal installation on on-prem. It's very easy. I mean, you install it, it's up and running. There's nothing you need to do beside running the installer. To be able to scale in an on-prem environment, you just add these type of nodes. That means you install another node that runs all the components and mm-hmm. connect it to the first node. And so you scale up your environment. And we have done, of course, we are doing a lot of load testing on both scenarios. And there's not what we recognized is that there's not that much of a disadvantage in using, let's say, this more easy deployment for on-prem, where all these components run on a single instance. Of course, these instances need to be bigger than as the ones that we are using for the SaaS deployment. Mm-hmm. But they scale pretty much like the SaaS ones. So we are running there already tests with six nodes with about 100,000 agents on that cluster. So that basically was the base architecture, the decisions we did, why we built things the way we built it. I mean, maybe one word to microservices at the end. You see we have only one server component that serves multiple purposes, but we had a strong requirement that the ease of installation and the ease of operation for our customers is a very high requirement, mm-hmm. which comes easier with a non-Microsoft microservice environment. So, so that was one of the main reasons. Also, which brought us into using that technology, that architecture. And I think this is somewhere unique for us, and it only goes with. So if you plan a system like that and you don't know the requirements beforehand, so that you need to do the things like scaling horizontally, multi-tenancy is important, easy deployment is important, it needs to run on-prem with installers as well as in SaaS. Mm-hmm. If you don't know that, you would not come up with that kind of architecture. Maybe you also cannot retrofit it. So mm-hmm. it was very important that at the beginning we were pretty clear about what we need to build.
Mm-hmm. And well, thanks, first of all. Now I have a couple of questions. Mm-hmm. And so I think you said the requirements obviously came because before we built Dynatrace, we had a lot of experience with Appmon. Mm-hmm. And I think some of the requirements were the limitations of Appmon. Like there was no scalability concept of the Appmon server.
Exactly.
And then the whole multi-tenancy. I mean, in Appmon, we had the concept of system profiles, multiple system profiles, agent groups, and it was kind of an option to kind of build multi-tenancy, quote-unquote, into a single Dynatrace Appmon installation, but obviously it was not well thought through and it was just not fit for that purpose. So I guess this is another requirement that came in.
Yeah, of course. I mean, we learned a lot with Appmon, and we learned what we need to do differently to scale out and to provide basically also more scalability, more availability by being able to horizontally scale, because scale not only brings scalability, it also brings availability. So we are not depending that everything is running all the time, so components can just diminish, because mm-hmm. that happens in the SaaS world very often, where instances get just killed arbitrary. Yeah. So that helped us there. And of course, we learned a lot of Appmon, and if we would not have done Appmon, we would not have done Dynatrace right.
Yeah. Then another question. So you mentioned that the server nodes, they fulfill multiple different purposes, mm-hmm. but basically they do everything, right? But I think we had a chat after the meetup, and you said that we would have a flag in there to yes. say you are doing just front end, you're just doing ingestion.
Exactly. So we can, of course, I mean, the server node still has all the code within, but we can, we have basically capabilities that we can enable or disable. It's not enabled currently, so we don't need it, but we easily can come up with a deployment model where, for instance, a server node only does web UI, mm-hmm. and another one just does ingest and real-time analysis of data. Mm-hmm. That would be possible. In very high scale environments, it might be an option that we are going after. Also, to not disturb, let's say, the data ingest with web UI on demand analyzers that are doing heavy analytics. So that's possible. That's feasible with the architecture we have. But still, the node can do everything. Mm-hmm. So it would not be something like where we would split up the code base into something mm-hmm. like this is running only the web UI, the on-demand parts, and the other one is doing the ingest and the real-time analysis. Mm-hmm. But configuration-wise, we would be able to set it up like that.
Mm-hmm. And the so we talked about this particular piece. Now, the updates. You talked about we are updating every other week. So every sprint mm-hmm. basically gets deployed yes. into an environment. Having a clustered architecture basically means this is a rolling update where we just update individual nodes one by one. Or how does that work?
Yes, exactly. That's working like that. Of course, there's still the option doing a hard stop and a complete upgrade. But we turned rolling update into our default mode this year. So since this year, we are only updating in a rolling mode. That means the cluster is up and running all the time. Mm-hmm. There's one node that gets updated. It gets off the cluster, gets updated, and joins the cluster after it's updated. Mm-hmm. And so all the other nodes are updated. Of course, that brings challenges with mm-hmm. you because you're running then, let's say, in this rolling phase, you are running the cluster in a mixed mode. That means with old and new nodes there, and you need to be aware of compatibility issues that can come up. And of course, with clusters, you need to then, if nodes go down and are replaced, you need to reshuffle work. So all this needs to work correctly to be able to do rolling updates.
Mm-hmm. And do you, I mean, there's once on the updates are on two sides, right? On the server side, there's updates, but also on our agents. Yes. So we obviously have our customers that monitor the environments, to install these agents. Yeah. We also have an automated update mechanism there. And does this work in a similar way, or how does this work there?
This is it's similar, but it's not equal, and it's not bound to the server update. So the server updates are independent from the agent updates. The server updates are basically, we looked at server updates are done all 2 weeks, and you get the newest features and newest functionality out very fast. For the agents, the customer controls it or can control it if he wants. Agent updates are all 4 weeks, for instance. So we have a longer phase on testing the agents because this is a really critical component for our customers. So there are two possibilities. The one is called auto update. Mm-hmm. That means if customers, for instance, in my test environment, in my development environment, we have turned on auto update because it's uncritical. We like to see new agent updates very early on and see the benefits. So that's completely automated. That means there's no interaction that the customer needs to do to update that. The other option is to basically control the update process mm-hmm. and say when I want to update mm-hmm. to which new version. And mm-hmm. this is where customers usually that are using it in large production environments mm-hmm. prefer basically the option of controlling the agent update. Yeah. But when they control it, it's completely automated again. I mean, mm-hmm. it's not so. So they can choose on which host groups they want to do the updates.
They can do. They can even test, let's say, test the update in a test environment
exactly.
first.
Exactly.
And then,
so they can they can control, for instance, that they want to do updates on, let's say, their environment first, in one environment first, and see if everything works fine, and then they just proceed then with their more critical mm-hmm. applications.
Mm-hmm. From a performance or from a capacity planning perspective, I'm pretty sure, I mean, we have a good understanding on how much capacity a regular cluster installation can handle, right?
Yes.
You probably run.
Yeah.
I know that Thomas Steinmaurer, he did a He did a presentation at a recent conference where he talked about continuous cluster validation. But are we then continuously validating cluster performance and then take this into account when scaling up or when spawning a new cluster? Is this how it works? Or do we have other mechanisms how we scale up and spawn a new cluster?
I mean, we are running 24/7 365 load testing, basically, yeah. on a very similar environment, or on a one-to-one environment that we are offering in SaaS as well as in managed. So we are running these load tests continuously with a higher load than we have in production. We are doing rolling updates during load tests. So we are not stopping load on that. Mm. So we are doing all the things that are happening within the production system, within the load test systems also. And that gives us a very good picture on, for instance, if we detect some performance regressions, we see them immediately and we can fix them. Mm-hmm. And of course, these numbers, combined with the numbers that come from the self-monitoring, mm-hmm. of our infrastructure, because we are using our product to monitor our product, of mm-hmm. course. So the combination of both inputs, like from the load test as well as from the real world production, gives us a very good estimate on the capacity we can handle and when we need to update or increase capacity for our systems. Mm-hmm. And we have means that, of course, automatically alert us on things where we know these need to be fixed. We're having means, if instances go down on SaaS, they're recreated automatically. So there's a lot of automation going, mm-hmm. on to help us to operate with minimal manual interaction.
Mm-hmm. That was what the industry now calls self-healing, even though it's obviously a very, yes. nice fancy term, but that's basically what we build.
Yes, this is a huge investment in overload protection and self-healing capabilities, mm-hmm. That we are doing, so that if a customer, for instance, is overloading our system because he's doing a load test against his system, which brings us more load, of course, when we are processing his data, we have capabilities to detect these situations, to minimize the impact on that load and still provide valid data, mm-hmm. so not skipping things and not providing consistent data, even situations where we see that we cannot process all the data that are coming in from agents, mm-hmm. we still are able to calculate the right metrics, so, mm-hmm. that you will not lose any of the most important informations about the system, even if we are under high load, if there's a node that goes down, and we see now instead of the three nodes, two nodes need to cope with the load, we have mechanisms to basically adjust the load level we can process without losing really meaningful data for the customer.
Mm-hmm. I think there's also a blog post from one of the architects on overload protection.
Yes.
I think if somebody wants to look into this, this is great. I think what's really great is the testimonial that we are using Dynatrace to monitor Dynatrace. Right?
Yes.
We are using Dynatrace to monitor, yeah. a very distributed high load environment, and not only in production, but also throughout the complete development process.
It's completely from the dev stage to the testing or the acceptance stage, how we call it. To production, so we are doing basically the same kind of testing there, and I'm interacting with our product on a daily basis, let's say even hours. I mean, I'm looking into the product all the time to, mm-hmm. improve basically our product. Mm-hmm. I don't need currently any other tools that help me to detect where we need to improve scalability, where we improve on performance issues. It comes all through Dynatrace data, mm-hmm. so no need to look into another thing, which,
yeah.
is great because we can use our own tools.
Our own tools, yeah. And also, I think what I always say when I talk with customers and prospects, other people just sell you tools because they want to sell you tools and they sell you what you should do, but we are actually doing it. We're doing continuous deployment. We are building applications, high scalable, that run in SaaS. So need our customers, right? And we have the tools to monitor. Very cool. Hey, Ernst, I know this was your first podcast and it went much a little longer than we anticipated, but I think it was so great to get all this information, and thank you so much, and hopefully have you back soon.
Thanks, Andreas.